The Emir is the master of everything he surveys, yet his desert country is an oasis of tranquility.
You are surrounded, Emir, by revolution. We call it the Arab Spring. How have you managed to avoid it?
We started our Qatari Spring a long time ago.
To be precise, 16 years ago, when the Emir overthrew his father in a palace coup and started creating a country which could startle anyone living anywhere else.
I think Americans are going to be shocked about a few things here. That there are no taxes, that electricity is free, health care is free, education is free. Sounds like a paradise.
Well, I welcome you in this paradise.
The Emir's paradise is rising from the sands along the western edge of the Arabian Gulf. In Doha, Qatar's capital, entire new neighborhoods have been built on land reclaimed from the sea. And the buildings have one thing in common, bling. Doha's skyline looks like it was designed by architects who didn't talk to each other, didn't like each other, and engaged in experiments they could never get away with at home. And a Qatari can live anywhere without ever leaving home. A virtual Venice is around the corner, Rodeo Drive is down the block, and there are world-class restaurants in the ancient Arab Souk, which was built 5 years ago. Fahad El Attiyah, one of the royal family's army of advisors, took us for a drive.
You were born here?
Yes. Born in Qatar.
There wasn't any of this?
There wasn't, yes.
Nothing?
Nothing.
How far back do you have to go? Your grandfather or your great-grandfather lived in tents?
My father.
Your father lived in a tent?
Yes. The amazing thing, it is my father's generation that transitioned from living in a tent to living in an urban environment, from commuting in a camel to commuting in a 747. And that transition within such a short period of time is astonishing.
The work is being done by a million-man army of immigrants. 94% of Qatar's labor force is foreign, Filipinos, Indians, Nepalese mainly, creating a home for a mere 250,000 Qataris. Paying for it? No problem. Qatar sits on top of the third largest natural gas reserves on the planet. A new plant called the Pearl turns those reserves into liquid fuels. It cost $18 billion and took 5 years to build. It is the largest, most sophisticated plant of its kind and a centerpiece of the Emir's strategy to keep Qatar rich. When we ran into him at its inauguration, he seemed genuinely proud.
Well, congratulations, now you've got the biggest plant in the world.
Oh, that's great. Well, I'm happy that they finish it.
Time is a precious commodity here. Everything's happening at once. They're finishing a new hospital. The Qatari say will be one of the most advanced in the world. There's a new concert hall with a new symphony orchestra. The Emir imported the musicians. Six American universities have built campuses here, offering American degrees in the heart of the Middle East. The Museum of Islamic Art, with a $1 billion collection, opened last year. Admission, of course, is free.
Everything is free. That become like a part of our culture. Definitely.
Sheikh Hamad bin Jassim is Qatar's prime minister.
Even when the people died, we take care of them.
Free funerals.
Yes.
From cradle to grave.
Yes.
Everything's taken care of.
That's we can make a logo.
This is a pretty good place to live.
Yes. We are living in good environments. Let us pray that the problems around us cool down.
Those problems, the chaos, violence, and killings throughout the Middle East are not cooling down at all. And many Arab leaders say to a large extent it is the Emir's fault. That's because of the television network he created 15 years ago. It's called Al Jazeera and does something unprecedented in the Arab world. It covers the news. It's on the air 24 hours a day, broadcast in Arabic and English, and is widely considered to be the engine of the Arab Spring.
I believe we made a good reform.
This was the first and the only network in the Arab world that was independent. Everyone else was just doing what their government told them to do.
Of course, It caused us a lot of a problem with the top people in the Arabs countries.
You say that Al Jazeera created problems for some leaders in the Middle East. It created big problems. It got them overthrown.
Well, I'm not sure if it's Al Jazeera was behind this.
He may not be sure, but others are. Egyptians watched the Tunisian revolution live on Al Jazeera, discussed it on Facebook, and took to the streets. Libyans watched the Egyptians, Yemenis watched the Libyans, and the Syrians watched them all. So is the Emir's emergence as the most influential leader in the Arab world. In England, he was hosted by the Queen. And last April, President Obama thanked him for helping promote democracy in the Middle East. But the Emir also has good relations with Hamas, the militant Palestinian group that runs Gaza, which the U.S. labels a terrorist organization.
Do the Americans ever come to you and say, hey, will you cut it out with Hamas? It's really bothering us.
They didn't like our relation with Iran, with Hamas, with Hezbollah. But then if you go to the other side, the Iranians, they don't like to see our relation with Israel. Hamas, they don't want to see our relation with Israel. So it's completely mixed.
What you see here is contentment. There have been no protests, no calls for democracy. After all, what could an opposition offer that Qataris don't already have? But the Emir just bought himself some additional insurance. He raised the salaries of all Qatari government workers by 60%. Soldiers and policemen got 120%. The Prime Minister insists this has nothing to do with politics.
We have one obsession, is how to continue to let the people live in the same standard. That's a very difficult target. We are trying to do that target.
Excellency, can you think of any other country in the world that has a better standard of living?
Well, there is a good living standard in many places in the world. But the main thing is what sort of quality of people you will produce. We would like our people not to be spoiled by this. We need our children not to be spoiled by this. That's, I think, the big challenge for us.
And there's a bigger challenge. Here is Qatar's military on parade at last month's National Day celebrations. Picturesque, but not very intimidating. Not when your next-door neighbors are Iran and Saudi Arabia. So how does the Emir keep his island of happiness afloat when the seas are getting rougher every day?
It often seems as if the basis of your foreign policy is to be friends with everyone.
Don't you think this is a good policy for a small country?
Yes, it is.
Well, we are trying.